I want to thank the organizers very much for inviting me to speak to you today. It's a real honor for me to be here, and I appreciate this very much. So my focus today is going to be on soil biological responses to biochar amendments. Most of you know what biochar is. I don't think it needs a lot of introduction, but I did want to just cover briefly what the proposed benefits are. We have a proposal that biochar represents very stable carbon and as such could possibly be used for climate change mitigation because of the stability of that carbon and its potential for sequestration in soil. In the actual act of pyrolysis, if we use waste materials, then we also have a waste management benefit from the whole biochar scenario. Co-produced with biochar is energy. Now, some systems allow that to just go out into the environment. The more conservative systems will gain both the energy component and the biochar component. And lastly, we have the soil improvement category and a number of hypotheses that have come forward as to why incorporating biochar in soil might lead to improvements in some qualities. From all of this, social and financial benefits are expected. So you can see here that we have very high expectations for what biochar has the potential to do for us. Question is, are we meeting all of those expectations? I want to focus on the soil amendment, soil management piece of the question, and look specifically at how soil biological communities are affected by biochar. Now, this diagram is a photo, is actually a bacterial live dead assay. And this particular piece of biochar came out of the Terra Preta soils. So we started our investigation and delving into the various aspects of biochar as a result of what we found in the Terra Preta soils in the Amazon. When we look at a micrograph like this, we see, oh, whoa, there's lots of things that are green that are lighting up. We see some hyphae in there, lots of different organisms colonizing this surface. But I question whether or not this is what we see with the new biochars that are being made and incorporated into soil. And there is some recent evidence that perhaps we don't see such high colonization, but that it may be more desert-like in the early days of biochar incorporation. So we'll have a bit of a look at that. Okay, so I want to make sure to preface all of my statements crediting Hugh McLaughlin in so far as biochars are not created equal. We have a term that is biochar. It's a catch-all phrase. I did an experiment with biochar. We did it here. We did it here. Many of the early reports say nothing happened. I didn't get a response, or I got a negative response. And we categorize those regardless of the response. We call it all biochar. But I think that we need to be more highly discriminatory in what we mean, because the variation is extremely high. The measurements we make on biochar amended soils change over time, and this is a very critical aspect. And so we need to get a handle on characterization, but that characterization needs to be linked to purpose. What are we trying to achieve when we actually amend soils with biochar? So I have to credit the IBI for trying to wrap their minds around a characterization scheme for different biochars. They're listing feedstock, the physical and chemical characteristics of the feedstock, as being important for the behavior of the resulting biochar in soil. Certainly process conditions, time and temperature are extremely important variables. And I know that many of you are looking at post-pyrolysis activation in some way to get a bigger bang for your buck when you're incorporating biochar in the soil. So post-pyrolysis processing is also something that's going to affect our results, as well as this plethora of physical and chemical properties that you see listed here. What ends up being the most critical in terms of being able to estimate where and under what conditions and with what crops in what regions we're likely to get a response to biochar amendment? But we also have to keep in mind, what do we actually mean by response? What is it that we are trying to achieve? Okay, so more to the point on biochars not being created equal. These are a range of biochars that were produced by David Garreña for some work that he did in Kenya. He used rice, bagasse, maize stover, maize cobs, tea prunings, dahlonics, and eucalyptus to prepare his chars. He pyrolyzed at two different temperatures, and then on top of that, he had a number of post-pyrolysis treatments. Now, I think you can easily see, I'm wondering if this might be easier than me bending and pointing, that we have different proportions of different characteristics. Now, this lower bar here is the stabilized carbon. On top of that is the ash component, and the very top here are bile oils, or what many call volatile matter that has been recondensed on the surface. So the first thing that you can see if you focus on just the ash alone is the variability across these feedstocks in terms of how much ash there is and the relative proportion of fixed carbon we have in there. But we also have a very wide diversity of volatile matter contents associated with these chars too. David pyrolyzed at 350 and 550 degrees C, and we can also see that the proportions of fixed carbon, volatile matter tends to go up, ash tends to go down, and stable carbon tends to go up as we increase in temperature. So we have quite a bit of variability there. He also looked at post-pyrolysis treatments. He looked at treating with acetone and rinsing in the hope to reduce the amount of volatile matter on the surface. He used an acid treatment to try to get rid of the mineral component. He did some steaming and he left them in water. And across all of the biochar types, a strong effect of the post-pyrolysis treatments was not seen at 350 degrees, but we do see it at 550 degrees. Again, a change in the proportional representation of fixed carbon. And in this case, we were trying to affect the quality and quantity of the volatile matter on the surface of the chars. Okay, so we know that they're very different. We know that they change over time. And we're asking questions about how does this affect soil quality. So soil quality is composed of physical, chemical, and biological characteristics. If you send a soil sample into a lab, they usually send you back physical and chemical characteristics and have largely ignored really the biological component. But we're becoming much more focused on that because we realize it's the biological community that is driving so many of the processes that are occurring below ground, and that we really do need to get a handle on the biological soil quality. Now, I've listed a few things here in red, which are some of the proposed benefits of biochar, is increased nutrient retention and release in particular, improved aeration, improved water retention, and on the biological side, these kinds of properties, pest suppression or pathogen suppression, improvements in encycling or not, as the case may be, effects on organic matter decomposition, and on the retention of microbes in soil that perhaps would normally be subject to high predation. Perhaps they can be present in larger quantities, and that might affect overall soil quality. So when we look at soil quality components then, and we look at how biochar might affect these, this is a very early on working model. We have our biochar that goes into soil, and remember, of course, its qualities are varying both with the feedstock and pyrolysis conditions. And we have microbes that are there in the soil, which are going to vary according to a lot of different variables. Soil type is particularly important, and we tend not to place enough emphasis on that. Climatic conditions that we find, and certainly the fertility of the soil, land use, and how management has affected that soil. But our model is basically, okay, we've got this biochar in here. What we expect is its porosity, water holding capacity, but we're really, really interested in its sorptive capacities as well, and how that quality affects what we see in terms of the behavior of the microbial community. So we've got our microbes there. What we anticipate is the way microbes eat. They produce exoenzymes in the soil. They decompose the organic matter in their vicinity, break it up into smaller components. So they're working on soil organic matter, producing inorganic nutrients. That then is the pool of nutrients that plants use for their own growth and production. And microbes also are using those things. So what's happening to all of this when we add this more stable form of carbon that is also covered with some unusual bio oils and condensates as a result of the pyrolysis process? So there are many, many papers out there. I've just finished revising, along with Matthias Rillig and Ellen Graber, the biological chapter for the second edition of the Biochar book. I think I perhaps went mad in the process. And I'll show you the reasons why in a moment. Not only are we in an exponential phase of growth with regard to publications on biochar and looking at various aspects, particularly of the soil microbial community, but we are also starting to understand more what the effects of feedstock by pyrolysis conditions actually mean. So there are a large number of papers out there. Some address the abundance of microorganisms, and you can see here some of the metrics that are used. Microbial biomass, excuse me. Phospholipid fatty acids, quantitative PCR, culturing has been used to ask questions, are we shifting the actual quantity of microorganisms out there? There are also many papers on activity measurements. We're very keen on activity measurements, particularly soil respiratory activity or carbon dioxide evolution, other greenhouse gases, and there will be other speakers in this session that will cover those aspects, and cycling. How are we affecting N availability and the pools in which we find nitrogen in the soil, effects on soil enzymes, effects on diversity, measured in a variety of ways. However, early papers and even many of the ones that are coming out now do not stop to examine what is happening to the actual method that they're using. Is it appropriate? Are you getting the same results? How does biochar affect your assay? Most of the things listed on the screen require some kind of an extraction, okay? We're doing assays on something that's been extracted from soil. So what we find is that we have, I'm gonna come back to that one. I really want to look at this one right now. We have the whole thing of adsorption that we need to deal with. And this is, I think, a very good and telling example. Those of you in the microbial world, you really have to wrap your minds around this. This affects DNA extraction, so even if you're looking at diversity, you've got to consider these things. The adsorptive capacity of biochar is something we kind of count on to hold mineral nutrients and to do a variety of things, but it also interferes with our ability to extract biological molecules. And it interferes with our ability to extract inorganic minerals as well. And so this is looking at adsorption of DOC over time when we have low, medium, and high biochar in soil. Excuse me, boy, it's really sensitive. So we need to keep this in mind. All right, so we've been working in an experiment in New York for the past 5 or 6 years. Hanyan Jin, who is in the corner there, did quite a lot of work on this field trial, and she tried to measure all of these different components, the microbial biomass, respiration, looking at diversity, and exoenzyme activities. And the first thing she had to do was to deal with this adsorption question and how that was affecting her assays. Because if we look at microbial biomass here, in terms of microbial biomass carbon, we've got both bulk soil, which is on this side of the graph here, and rhizosphere soil. If we look at the unadjusted measures of microbial biomass, yes, we are increasing microbial biomass as we increase the amount of biochar that has been applied, and here we have 0, 1, 12, and 30 tons per hectare going up along the line. However, when you take into account the adsorptive properties and what we're losing in terms of DOC and make a correction for that, we're seeing even a larger probability of an increase in that soil microbial biomass in both the bulk soil and in the rhizosphere soil. So remembering to account for sorption is quite critical. Okay, I'm going to show you a number of tables that look like this. I apologize for the small print, but these are directly out of the chapter that we just prepared for the biochar book, and I have a point in showing these to you. I have the microbial abundance variable in the first column there. The most important thing, my point here, is for you to look at what these trends are. Now, I selected these particular papers on purpose. All the rest of the papers that have been reporting these up until, let's say, January, will appear in the chapter. I looked at what sort of soil type they were going in. It matters. How the biochar was produced. It matters. What that feedstock is also matters. Then we look at sampling time, and we're in such early days with biochar now that we don't have very many long-term experiments for us to actually work in to see how things are changing over time. Are we moving more toward a tata preta situation, or are we not? And then I've listed whether they're field, lab, other factors. But have a look at these trends. These microbial biomass were all done by a technique called fumigation extraction. Emphasis on extraction. Okay, so we're running into a bit of difficulty there with our extracts. We have everything from NC, no change. Decreasing for microbial biomass C, but for microbial biomass N, not so much. Again, no change here compared with increases that we see. These are actually from our experiments measured at 6 and 18 months. And then we have also decreases reported. So in my abstract, I made mention of a dog's breakfast, and that's really what we're looking at here with a lot of these microbial responses. We focus on the response, but we're not really getting at the underlying mechanisms. And I think Kurt's going to give us a very interesting talk on some potential underlying mechanisms that may throw even another wrench in the works in terms of understanding biological responses. So they're basically all over the map. For us, over time, we found the biomass increased. Other ways that people have looked at biomass is to look at quantitative PCR of N-cycling genes. Now, take a look here again in the column in red. Those are the trends. So some folks have looked at ammonia monooxygenase as a indicator of nitrification. No change, but I see increases in some studies reported. The near S, K, Z, H, those are all genes involved in denitrification. So some people are finding either no change or an increase in that. Others are finding actual decreases in the gene copies for these particular process, particular genes that then produce the enzymes that catalyze these processes. So again, quite a lot of diversity there. CO2 evolution. This one has been reported probably most often in terms of microbial responses, and it's measured as CO2 evolution. One thing to keep in mind is that the role of carbonates and carbonate dissolution is usually not accounted for in any of these studies. It's kind of lumped in with what we see with microbial biomass. CO2 evolution, which is interpreted as microbial respiration in soil. So the measurement of CO2 coming off is an activity measurement for the soil biota. Again, look at that trend column. Up then down, no change, down then down, up for 15 days, then it goes down. How do we actually make sense of what's happening with these data? And again, keep in mind we're crossing all kinds of different soil types, all kinds of different production parameters, all kinds of different feedstocks associated here. So in our hands, when we looked at it in the field experiments that we had in New York, we were finding results that were somewhat similar to what we found with the Terra Preta soils. Increased biomass, but decreased respiratory activity as the quantity of biochar was increased in soil. So here in the bulk soil, the highest level of biochar application resulted in the lowest amount of respiratory activity. However, if we look in the rhizosphere soil, we don't see any particular differences. Now, we have quite a bit of difference between what's in the rhizosphere and going on and what's going on in the bulk soil. In the rhizosphere, we have root exudates. We have a lot of rich carbon compounds that are there that microbes can use, and it's normally a hotbed of activity, and we see a lot of CO2 respiration. If, in fact, there is any limiting effect here, it's pretty much swamped by the amount of carbon that we have in the rhizosphere. But in the bulk soil, this is a tough environment. Increasing biochar here, what this is telling me, is not increasing metabolizable carbon to any great extent. In fact, I want you to think about what our biochar is like when it goes into soil. Is it likely to stimulate activity? It's got a lot of bile oils on it. These are very complex compounds, some of which are actually toxic. So are we, in fact, seeing a biofumigation type of effect going on here with some of the biochars that we're applying to soil? And what might the consequence of that be? We were quite interested in going back and having so if we look at the metabolic quotient, I did want to mention this quickly, which is looking at the units of respiration over the units of biomass. And what we're seeing then is a decrease in this metabolic quotient that initially was leading us to believe that we were having carbon savings here, carbon reacquisition within the soil, and an actual decrease, darn it, in respiratory activity. So is this a carbon conservation type of scheme that we're looking at here? Is one question that we were trying to address, and then how might that change over time? Okay, so I was very excited to go back after a couple of years and have a look at what was going on in these soils. We had seen all kinds of changes in the first and second seasons of cultivation of, we were growing maize. So at 5 years, I kind of thought, okay, well, we're going to have some more dramatic effects here. Wrong. The opposite. Now in the bulk soil, we're looking at really no differences here between the application rates of the biochar in a six-week incubation in the field. So that depression in respiration, we're not seeing it anymore at 5 years. Okay, so we had a look at bacterial diversity, and this was done using a PCR fingerprinting method called terminal restriction fragment length polymorphisms. And it's essentially a way to look at the diversity of genomes that are out there in a fairly broad sense. When we looked at bacteria, and these are terminal fragments analyzed from the amplification of the 16S ribosomal DNA. So these are the ribosomal genes, very good target, very high stability. When we looked at the bacteria under this assay at 24 months, we could see very much a push in one direction or another, depending upon the rate of biochar that we applied. So early on, we really are pushing this community in a particular way. If we look here below the line, these are our low application rates, and above the line, these are our higher application rates. Within the circle is our bulk soil, and the triangles are our rhizosphere soil. So one check on this whole process is we expect to see a big difference between bulk and rhizosphere, and if we don't see it, then I start to worry overall about everything. But we see very great discrimination between bulk soil and rhizosphere, and we are seeing these populations moving in response to the level of biochar we put in. Now, we had a look at this in 2007 and in 2008, and you can see this is for the bacteria. These are for the fungi. Again, we're looking at low application rates versus higher application rates across 2 years. So in 2007, we're starting to see that migration happening. Darn it. And in 2008, it was even more pronounced for both the bacteria and the fungi, and particularly pronounced with the fungi. So what did we see? Increased microbial abundance, decreased CO2 evolution, a push in the diversity in what direction we're not particularly sure. We know we've got seasonal changes that are also part and parcel of this, and do also keep in mind the root environment will matter. what kind of species we have there. Okay, so I went back again after 5 years and had another look at the diversity. And here we've got the rhizosphere. And you can see the color scheme here relates to the amount of char that was applied. Basically, we have a bit of a grouping at 0 tons per hectare, but the rest is just all over the map. We're not seeing the kind of discrimination that we saw after the first 2 seasons. It's just not there. When we look at the bulk soil, same thing. Whatever direction we pushed that community, it's starting to coalesce and become more similar regardless of the amount of biochar that you applied. So the duration of the effects we see is something we really need to pay attention to, and the lack of long-term trials has been somewhat hampering us in this regard. Okay, so there's our bulk and rhizosphere comparison. And again, you know, if I don't see this, then I think there's something wrong, but I very clearly do see a difference in populations in bulk and rhizosphere, but not in relation to the biochar applied. Okay, so enzyme activities is another thing that people have looked at. Again, look at the trend that, column there. Assay and soil dependent. Hallelujah. Yes, it is. Now, you've got to think about enzyme activities, and a few of you out there do measure these things, often by putting in a fluorogenic compound that you then expect to be able to get back out and measure in a spectrophotometer. You've got to deal with adsorption. So, fairly common in enzyme activities, we see a decrease in beta-glucosidase, so that's a change in carbon metabolism we see quite regularly, and increase in phosphatases is also fairly common observation. But most of the rest of the enzymes, up and down, up and down, up and down, depending on the conditions that we see. Now, when we looked at enzyme activity and we used a fluorogenic marker that we had to extract from the soil, basically, our biochar line came up, and then it crashed. Whereas the non-biochar amended soils basically followed these curves. So we went to look at a different type of assay called enzyme-linked fluorescence. Here, the reaction actually happens in situ, and a fluorescent precipitate is precipitated at the point of contact. So now we don't have to deal with any kind of an extraction procedure and can have a better look. And what we're seeing here in the biochar amended soils is we actually have quite a bit of enzymatic activity that is happening in situ on these biochar particles. So here we can see increases in phosphatase activity. If you look at the unamended control, we're really not seeing much in the way of activity here. Also, in some cases, increase in beta-glucuronidase in this case. So some enzymes do increase, some enzymes decrease. But it is, again, all over the map. So then we went to look at what is happening within this population, and we used a geochip microassay to look at it. This is the protocol that's basically used. There's the development of the chip itself, preparation of the target, so our extracted DNA out of the sample, and then the actual analysis that goes on from there. The geochip is a pretty amazing tool. It has all these different gene targets or probes that are on it. They can retrieve a wide variety of sequences. So this is an extremely comprehensive type of assay. When we went to look at the outcomes of the soil that had been amended 5 years previously, this is some of the stuff that we saw. Again, rhizosphere soil, bulk soil. Easy to discriminate in terms of functional genes. If we look at the rate of biochar applied, it's just not there. It's looking basically the same as our background community. So what's happening to this biochar in soil? Why do we see early interactions that are shifting things quite dramatically, but after a few years, we're really not seeing much of anything or much discrimination here, regardless of the tool that we use? Okay, now others have looked at encycling processes, and again, have a look at this trend column. Nitrogen mineralization, nitrification, those are often measured, so we have some studies that are finding that it decreases. Some studies say it increases for a little while, and then it basically drops back down. Here, no change. Here, an increase in nitrification. Here, a decrease in nitrification. So again, we've got variation in soil type, production conditions, feedstocks, etc. How do we make sense of all of these data? Also on the N side of the equation is biological nitrogen fixation. There are several studies out there that have looked at this. We have looked at this in Kenyan soils, and I see a much more promising avenue for biochar in its relationship with biological nitrogen fixation. For these studies here, increase in nodulation, increase in nitrogen fixation, increase in nitrogen fixation, and that is indeed what we also see. So this experiment was done by David Garreña. He used a 100-year-old continuous corn soil from Kenya. These are his different feedstocks across here that we saw at the beginning of the piece. And we're looking at nitrogen derived from fixation and nodule counts against an unamended control here. In all three of these metrics, we have a huge bang for our buck in terms of what's happening with biochar addition. Huge increases in nodulation, huge increases in nitrogen fixation, and huge increases in yield, unlike what we had seen under the New York scenario. We're pushing our mind in a particular direction here. We were thinking about what components of the biochar might be affecting biological nitrogen fixation. Do we see it associated with perhaps the mineral component? If we remove the mineral component, we're removing a lot of the phosphorus. Are we then affecting nitrogen fixation negatively? And what is the role of more available phosphorus in the nitrogen fixation process? We also were thinking about whether or not the bio-oils on the surface might actually give us some signaling mimics in some way that enhances the communication between rhizobia, plant roots, resulting in better nodulation. But we actually saw when we removed the volatile matter, we had an even more enhanced nodulation and nitrogen fixation. So the volatile matter is not enhancing it. It's actually a bit of a detractor here for this particular process. Okay, this is a really tough diagram. I'm going to actually skip over it and move to this one. Looking at interactions in the rhizosphere, another important microbial characteristic is the crosstalk that happens between chemicals that are produced in the rhizosphere, chemicals produced by microorganisms, and then how they affect each other. And this is a summary of the types of molecules that are produced by roots that have bioactivity on the microbial community. So we see things like flavonoids, very important for nodulation, cytokinins for cell proliferation, various fatty acids and proteins affecting the behavior of this rhizosphere community. But what happens when we put biochar in there? And this is a photo from a paper by Masiello, which was the first one to actually have a look at whether biochar is interfering with signal reception between the emitter and the receiver. And essentially what they found, they actually put their organism here and looked at whether or not the signal that was required for a response in that bacteria was being detected on the other side of agar with biochar inside of it. And essentially what they found was, if you don't have biochar, your responding community responds. When you have biochar, you're not getting a response. So what are the consequences for us now if biochar is adsorbing really important signaling molecules that are critical for particular responses in soil? And biological nitrogen fixation is only the start of it in terms of signaling compounds. Okay, so biologically, amongst the other things that we've had a look at are the potential to reduce soil-borne disease. There's a number of studies out there that report this, both for soil-borne pathogens, but also for aerial pathogens. Why would that be? What are we doing here? Are we inducing some kind of systemic resistance in the plant that would then protect both the rhizosphere and the aerial parts of the plant from infestation by pathogens? This is very early days in this kind of work, but something that's quite promising. We're actually looking at the ability of both biochar and vermicompost to reduce plant soil-borne pathogens in some of these extremely depauperate soils in Kenya, and we're seeing actually quite dramatic responses to both of those factors. So we do have some potential here for disease reduction. Okay, so I hope you can appreciate what a dog's breakfast these biological responses are, that we have so many reports out there of a phenomenological nature reporting, I saw this change, I saw this change, I saw this change, but fundamentally, why are we seeing it? What is the mechanism that is driving these various responses? And I think Kurt's going to make a few suggestions later on in the day, but a mechanistic understanding of how biochar is interacting with the soil and with the soil biotic community is absolutely essential. Are we looking at biochar as an electron shuttle? Will it actually improve the ability of microbes to respire anaerobically, for example, or to do things that rely on electron transfers, most specifically for things like nitrification, the movement of ammonium to nitrate, that oxidation, that electron transfer that's going on, where the microbes use that to actually fix carbon dioxide. Can we make that process? Is it more efficient? Is it not more efficient? Again, reports are all over the map. So I'm urging you in your studies, particularly you young scientists, not to get caught up in what we call winfinity, that biochar is a win-win-win-win-win-win-win on everything. That is turning out not to be the case. We need to know more about all of the characteristics I described before, the feedstock, the pyrolysis conditions, post-pyrolysis treatments, time, temperature, and what type of soil you're putting this in. We see some responses in temperate soils, they disappear over time. We see dramatic things happening in tropical soils, but we don't have that time component available to us. We don't really know what's happening over time. So focusing more on mechanisms, understanding that biochar has characteristics when it goes into the soil, but these change dramatically over time. And how the microbial community is going to interact with biochar, whose characteristics are changing over time, they will also change over time in terms of how they're behaving. So let's get ourselves on more of a mechanistic footing. How do we characterize these chars? We have a lot of producers in the audience, and I apologize for the sort of academic stuff, but hopefully you've got the take-home message is, what is it that your biochar is going to do in that soil? And oftentimes you see great claims about particular chars, and then you go ahead and try it, and you don't see anything. So we've got to be careful that biochar doesn't get a bad name here, because the responses are so incredibly variable. Instead, we really need to get a more fundamental understanding so we can actually predict better what those outcomes are likely to be. Okay, so these are the folks whose data I showed you in this presentation, and I'll take questions. Thanks.